One lifetime, a show comes around that goes beyond all of your expectations. It makes your heart pound, your eyes water, and literally knocks your pretty little socks right off. This is not that show. But if you're looking for sports, comedy, and entertainment that's usually pretty decent and only occasionally mediocre, you have come to the right place. Here, the hosts and special guests may come and go, but this show is always for the people and always delivers plenty of giggles and sleeveless shirts. Buckle up, buttercups. This is the Behind the Mic Show.
I tell you what, Brian Lane, that video from Lisa Herman never gets old. I love that video. Probably the greatest video montage of all time. And Delaney, don't forget to unmute yourself, you know, so get with the tech world. Still can't hear you, pal. Unmute.
There you go.
There he is. All right, here we go. But anyway, welcome everyone once again. We want to thank Lisa Herman for that awesome video and Lane Pye for being the techie guy that takes care of it. But welcome to the Behind the Mic Show. We come at you each and every week with something new and exciting. And this week we have something special. That's not outer space behind me, folks. No, that is an artistic creation from one Crystal Dulaney, a very patient woman, very understanding woman, but also very artistic. Such is life. So welcome. And we're going to have her later on in the show. And with me each and every week from clear over by Edwardsville, Illinois, Brian Big Daddy Lane Pye. Looks like it almost looks like only Tigers, but it's not. It's the Edwardsville Tigers. Thank God. How's things been going for you, Lane Pye?
Doing well. Just been busy and work and everything. And if I have to jump off here tonight, it's because we're currently dealing with some stuff at work, but otherwise doing well. Got done with Edwardsville's first exhibition tennis match this season, and the Tigers did very well, and so did one Alex Lane. So it's off. You know, we're getting back to normal here with sports, hopefully, and all good things. So
tell us about this Alex Lane kid. What did he do today?
Today he played in doubles. He and his doubles partner won. They played one pro set to 8. He won 8-0 with his partner in doubles. And then in singles, he won in two sets, 6-2 and 6-4. So played very well.
Good God. Wow. Now, can he play with both hands like Lane? There's no backhand. You're just two forehands.
No, he's too good for that.
Oh, okay. I see. Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, Cole, which will I find that more entertaining. But anyway, well, that's great. Thanks for being on. I know it's been a crazy week. And if you got to step away, you step away. And that's what we do. We'll just keep the cameras rolling, baby.
We'll keep the cameras rolling. So.
Yeah, that's right. And with us, as always, from up there in the great north, don't know how the weather is these days. Hopefully getting better. But Brian, dude, looks like Elaney. How are things with you, sir?
Good. Not bad. Good. And the weather's not great. No, it's only like in the 50s. We had a nice couple days a couple weeks ago, and that was a tease. So now we're just looking at 30s overnight, 54, 55 high, windy. Mm-hmm. So, you know, just like the great white north, North Pole, whatever you want.
Yeah. What is your spring and summer last about 3 weeks? Is that what you get?
Yeah, more or less. Yeah. Maybe. I mean, that's individual days. It's not consecutive either.
Yeah, God, I don't know why you live in that godforsaken place. I have no idea.
I don't know.
It's never
I'm stuck
warm.
Here now.
Oh, jeez.
Well, then it turns miserably humid and hot, like in July, August, oftentimes. So you get the kind of the all extremes, unfortunately.
I heard there's beautiful land up there, right? God's country.
It really is.
Call it? Is
absolutely.
That right?
It is. Yeah. It looks a little like Southern Illinois. There's a lot of the bluffs, and there's a lot of people. There's a lot of people do a lot of hiking. I don't, of course, hiking and biking, and it's quite beautiful.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
It's quite nice. Mm-hmm. Once you hit, I don't know, like kind of Madison or maybe a little bit further north, than that, then it's pretty much like northern Illinois, pretty flat. But up here along the Mississippi, it's quite beautiful, actually.
I see. Well, that sounds lovely. Well, to those of you out there, thanks for joining us. Do us a favor and share the show if you enjoy it. Let's get more people watching. But we want to thank each and every week, of course, our sponsor, Bill Atwood, at North Wayne Insurance Agency. All your insurance needs, make sure and contact Bill. Practices what he preaches. Good man. Works in the community. So you know what? He supports this show, so support him. Contact him for any insurance questions you may have. So as Lane said, he may have to step away, might have some issues. And folks, if you're out there, feel free to chime in. Delaney and I always watch the questions roll in, and we'll do some sports topics, of course, like we always do, or try to. And then we're gonna have Crystal come on here at about 8:30 to talk about her incredible artwork. So that's gonna be awesome to talk about as well. Just something new, Delaney, for the people, you know, something we like to keep the variety up. Just never know where it's going to go. So you get a little bit of everything. You know what I'm saying? So, all right. First topic. And it's just me and you, looks like, Delaney. So we're just going to rock this thing. And anybody out there watching will chime in. Feel free. But the Masters, did you watch?
I unfortunately did not. I watched, well, I mean, not zero, but not much either, actually, though. I thought it was pretty cool to see. I don't butcher his name, Matsuyama. Is that right? Did I say that right?
Yeah, very good. Hideki Matsuyama. Yes.
Hideki. To see him win. It sounds like Sunday was kind of anticlimactic, generally speaking. There wasn't a lot of like Jim Nance, holy cow movements.
No.
Bubba hitting stuff out of trees or anything like that. So,
right.
So no, I didn't get a chance to watch it, but it sounds like it was, you know, so it's the Masters. DJ didn't do well, and sounds like Spieth had a nice run the last day or so, but otherwise he just ran out of steam. And
yeah,
did you get a watch?
DeChambeau didn't do much.
No, he didn't do anything, did he?
Yeah, no. And Matsuyama, cool, you know, the first Japanese player to ever win, so that's awesome. Very humble young man. In fact, I seen a picture that they showed to him where he's waiting at the airport to fly just on a regular airplane. He didn't have a private jet, nothing like that, just won the Masters. Yeah, the best part is he's on his phone looking at something, and he's got the green jacket just laid over a chair right there as he's waiting to get on these planes, just like the rest of us getting on the same plane. I'm like, wow, how cool is that? I'd be wearing that damn jacket everywhere I go. It's not just hanging off to the side. That thing would be going. I'd be sleeping with that thing. But also, one highlight from the Masters, did you happen to see the guy that was, I don't know if he's in second place, third place, I'm not sure, Will Zalatoris. Did you have to check this guy out, Blaine?
No, I heard a little people. There's some chatter about him. I don't know much more about that. Yeah. He's a young guy.
Very young guy, but he also looks just exactly like Happy Gilmore's caddy.
Really? I didn't see that. Actually,
that he choked. You know, so so yeah, he looked yes, and actually Travis Cooper, with the green jacket, I would most definitely cut off the sleeves. I think that'd be a good look with that jacket. Something new, something exciting.
Can you imagine?
You sit there.
Hey, can someone give me a pair of scissors? As soon as
this isn't gonna work. I can't breathe. I can't turn. I can't. Yeah, it's just this doesn't work for me. But no, the dude looks just like Happy Gilmore's caddy at the start, that he chokes and, you know, beats on the ground and all that before he gets the bum. But anyway, he played great. He really did. He had a nice tournament. Boy, that kid is thin. He can't weigh 110 pounds. Lane, do you know what I'm talking about? Did you see this kid?
Yeah, actually. So I watched quite a bit of the Masters, and
We have someone talking intelligently here.
He played really well. He strikes the ball incredibly crisp for a small guy. I mean, he really does smash the ball. And he is he's a good iron player. So like Tiger of old, when you can play your irons real well, you can play the Masters pretty well. And that course first 3 days was fast. Like, there's always the difference between the AM PM rounds in the Masters. And so the greens were incredibly quick. They were running hard, and it was an eye opening, I think, to some of the pros who had even just played on it. You got to realize they do this practice rounds just a few days before, and then they come back, and so there were some bad scores put first, and then Hideki just kind of went on a roll. Day three puts up a massive score, and then you have the young kid, what's his name again,
Zalatoris.
Yeah,
played really well. I had my prediction was Jordan Spieth. He played okay. I think he ended up third, tied for third. And then Xander Schauffele played real well. It was a fun Masters to watch. I know they said the ratings were low and maybe because of Tiger and because the show didn't really do well come Friday. I think that was part of the issue too. Thursday and Friday, Bryson didn't play very well. Saturday played better, but then of course
too late. And boy, they fixed the Dustin Johnson problem after he set a record there, you know, the last time they played, which wasn't long ago. And I apparently, from what the word is, the members of the club didn't care for that score that Dustin Johnson put up. So they fixed that problem, didn't they? Yeah. So you could make that golf course. I can't even imagine. I was talking to my mom on Sundays. We were watching a little bit of it. And I mean, the most beautiful golf course you'll ever see. Good God. You know, the azaleas are everywhere. And I mean, it is pristine. I would like just to walk around the place. I don't want to shoot golf there, because I don't have enough golf balls to get through that. I bet I would shoot at least, it's got to be 200. I mean, I'm not joking when I said there's no way.
Literally.
Because this is what, like, I was telling mom. So we saw one thing on there, and the green was just doing this and like this, whatever. And she's like, my God, look at that green. I said, Mom, there are no straight putts on that golf course. I said, you know, like, no. You go to Flora Country Club, let's say, and the greens are you know, smaller. And there's flat parts, stuff like that. I said, these greens are 10 times the size, and there's not a flat part anywhere. And it's brass. And so when you cuss a guy, he's like, how does he miss a 3-foot putt? You have no clue how much break there is of that 3-foot putt. It's just amazing.
There was one, and I know our viewers will know the hole and the player better, but I think he had like a 5-foot putt to maybe get a birdie or par. Mm-hmm. He misses the putt, hits it on the downslope. So he misses the cup, goes off the green, off the fringe, in the water. On a putt.
On a 5-foot putt.
On a 5-foot putt. He missed, I think it was around 5. It wasn't a long putt. It wasn't like he had that much mustard behind it, but he just missed the cup, and then it just kept going, and it kept going. And like I said, went off the green, off the fringe, into the water. And I'm like, I'd have been so mad.
And you know what follows that, Lane? Well, the putter throw. That's what I do. Is that putter goes about 100 yards.
Uh-oh, here comes the putter throw.
There was, again, I can't remember all the names of the guys, but one golfer did break his putter on Saturday.
J.R. Lewis shared that. Yeah, I saw that. He had to finish, like, putting with his driver, right?
3-wood. He was putting with a 3-wood, and he actually did very well. I mean, like, the ball.
I saw him doing that. Well, I didn't. I was like, what the hell is he doing?
Yeah, he broke his putter on, like, one of the other holes. Yeah.
Okay.
So he had to go putt with a 3-wood. And again, like I said, I was amazingly surprised at how well, because, you know, the ball tends to kind of hop off, especially a 3-wood, because it's not as flat as a driver. And so it has a little bit of a hop. He was hitting it very smooth. Of course, again, then again, they're pros. And so that's why they're pros. They can do stuff.
Right. Indeed. Indeed. Ratings down. People weren't really into it. I mean, and I think that's the Tiger effect. I mean, that's a lot of it. Or if they don't
that's our show. I called that last week.
Yeah, but we're gonna. I'm telling you, man. Maybe it wasn't me. They're gonna have to get used to that, because we may not have Tiger. We may not have Tiger again in golf.
That's
so
right.
We're gonna have to have this next set of stars come through, and I think we got a few. But like somebody said, they just don't realize how what Tiger did was how difficult it was, because we've had great golfers before, and
but to have that sustained success that he had for so long, you know, to be the best for that long, I don't know if you'll ever see that again. Now, granted, you get those generational talents, you know, every so often, 20, 25 years, it comes around. And, you know, we may still be a ways from that dominant. So everybody's so good anymore, you know, is where you see one guy's on top one week, but then the next week there's somebody else. It's just, it's a whole different world. So,
but
that's what golf needs. So,
Tiger's
for sure. Maybe Tiger's kid, because that kid looks like pretty damn good.
I know, right? Yeah, you could smoke all three of us right now.
for sure.
All right, up next. That happened this weekend. WrestleMania. Did you guys watch any wrestling at all? Delaney, nothing.
No, I'm an adult. I didn't watch it.
Unbelievable. I tell you what, I was entertained. It was nice to see. They had like 25,000 people there, supposedly social distancing. But when I'm watching it, they're hitting that lower bowl. There's no social distancing. You know, I mean, it's like, here we go. But no, I thought they did a pretty good job considering. You could tell with a crowd, it makes a difference for sure, because these wrestlers have been doing this for like a year straight now with no crowd. So it made a big difference. And Bad Bunny. Now, Delaney, I know you've heard of Bad Bunny, right?
I've heard him. I don't know much more about it, but I guess, you know.
Yeah. Lane Pye, you've heard of Bad Bunny?
Yes. Bad Bunny. I don't know if I have.
Hispanic rapper, I believe, Puerto Rican something like that. Yeah, mega superstar, Bad Bunny. He actually was in a wrestling match, and he did fantastic. He really did. He'd been training for a few months, and he did all sorts of different moves and stuff. I was like, holy crap, wow, look at this, you know, because a lot of times you get a celebrity on, they'll do, you know, body slammer, clotheslines, and it's pretty simple. You know, like for instance, my wrestling matches that I did, keep it simple, you know. but he was going off the top rope. He's doing all sorts of things. Like, this guy's worth hundreds of millions of dollars already. He's crazy. Really, yeah, nuts. Yeah. But
his manager's like, oh, Jesus.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Well, can you imagine the insurance policy he had to get out for that just in case? Oh, my God. You know, crazy. And also one of the coolest things was the main event for night one had the first African-American women to ever do the main event. And it was really cool. They put and it, what was cool to me was the emotion that those two women had, because, you know, for years, obviously, it's just been mostly men. Yeah, there may be a female match, but it was just kind of, you know, a tag team or whatever. But now they're starting to main event a little bit. And this was two African-American women. And you could tell the emotion between those two is they kind of had to pause before they started because they were kind of overwhelmed. The crowd was behind. That was really, really cool moment.
That's pretty cool.
But overall, I thought it was pretty cool. So anyway, that was, you know, WrestleMania was fine. And we don't have a ton of wrestling fans, so we'll move on.
Well, I do have one quick question. What was the deal with, was it Braden Wyatt and Alyssa somebody? I did see one thing about wrestling. Was
Alyssa Bliss.
What happened there? Did she like
Here's the thing. Braden Wyatt is also the Fiend.
A demonic creature,
if you will. Now, mind you, a few months ago, he was burned alive and it killed him in the ring. Okay. They set, Randy Orton set him on fire. Okay. So supposedly killed him. But here at WrestleMania, of course, they've been building up and the Fiend come back. He was all like had a mask where he's all burnt, you know, like a horror movie, whatever. And, but then Alexa Bliss, who's basically been his little helper, and she's psychotic as well. She turns into supposedly what they're saying is maybe Bray Wyatt's sister, Sister Abigail. Dwayne, you know what I'm talking about here. But anyway, she's set up on top of this big box. It was like a Jack in the Box that, you know, the Fiend had come out to start the deal. And a bunch of black ooze came down her face, and it distracted him. And Randy Orton took him out. It's like she took his power, took him out with an RKO. Mind you, this guy was set on fire two or three months ago, killed, basically comes back. That's fine, but one RKO gone. So I'm not real sure. I don't know if that was
really... I'm glad I had the backstory because I didn't read it, so I'm glad you told me, because that's much better.
Saves you time. But that's what was those characters started out so cool, and they just screwed it up like they do so often. So it is what it is. All right, next topic, little sports here. Julian Edelman just called it quits, had a hell of a career. Actually, we got some great people watching tonight. Nice to see some old friends again watching. But Julian Edelman hangs it up, Delaney. Put out a nice 3 or 4 minute video. I guess he had a knee issue, couldn't pass the physical, or this is calling it quits for a little while and then going down. And Colin Dickey, who hasn't joined us in a while, but he's back and he's already pissed. Where's the real Delaney? I'm about to turn this shit off. About 15 minutes. Hang on there, Dickey. Just hang on. Get you a nice bourbon, a cigar.
Yeah, get you a drink, cigar, and have a seat.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, yeah. And also just know your role and shut your mouth. So don't be making demands.
More
than
anything.
That's right. Anyway, so Julian Edelman calls it quits. Now, I think it's part of a greater plan to where maybe he can get down there with Tommy Boy and get him another title and, you know, all that stuff, but we shall see. But they're talking now that maybe Edelman is a Hall of Famer, Delaney. Okay. Hall of Fame. Now, let me read you some stats here, real quick. 11 seasons. Now, don't get me wrong. Great career.
A lot of
Super Bowl titles, right? Things like that. But in 11 seasons, 620 receptions. Okay. That ranks 75th all time. 6,822 yards. That's 156th all time. 36 touchdowns. That's not even in the top 250. Okay. Never made a Pro Bowl. Never an all-pro. However, in the postseason, which he played a lot of postseason games, 180 receptions, 1,442 yards, 5 touchdowns. Basically, the only person in front of him is Jerry Rice when it comes to stuff like that in the postseason. Right. And as we know in sports, the better you do in the postseason, the more legend that you have, obviously, in terms of getting you know, into the hall and things like that. but they're saying Hall of Fame. Do you agree with that, Delaney? Is he a Hall of Famer? Those of you watching right now, is Julian Edelman a Hall of Famer? What are your thoughts, Delaney?
That's tough, you know, because, you know, he's a good wide receiver that had the benefit of playing with arguably the greatest quarterback ever, but that, you know, that's not his fault or whatever. Mm-hmm. His regular season stats are, I'd say, mediocre, but they're good, but they're okay. But I tell you what though, like, you know, so you were just talking about the postseason stuff, top 5 most catches, Super Bowl history, most receiving yards, Super Bowl history, number 4, 100 yard receiving games, NFL history, number 2, Most catches in NFL playoff history, second, and most receiving yards in NFL playoff history, second behind Jerry Rice. Mm-hmm. Both those had an MVP, and I think the first of the three he's won. So
yeah,
I guess you could make a pretty good argument for him based on his postseason numbers, but I don't know. You know, I could be convinced either way. He just doesn't strike you as like, all right, this guy's this is a Hall of Famer. Like, wait a minute, you're talking about Sam Edelman, right? I mean, he's a wide receiver.
Oh, you know, he's great. The guy's tough, played through a lot of pain. Yeah. I think he's had a lot of concussions, things like that. But to give you an example of wide receivers that aren't in the Hall of Fame yet, Torrey Holt, okay, former Rams receiver, 920 receptions, 13,382 yards, 74 touchdowns, so dwarfs. Now, granted, they play different positions, one slot, one's, you know, whatever. But he also has a Super Bowl title. Sterling Sharp, 595 receptions. Now, mind you, Sterling Sharp got his career cut short. But 8,124 yards, 65 touchdowns, and four fewer seasons than Edelman. And then Wes Welker, who basically was, I mean, pretty much a teammate there for a while, played similar positions. 903 receptions, 9,924 yards, and 50 touchdowns. But is Edelman a Hall of Famer? Lane Pye, welcome back. Yeah. What are your thoughts?
I don't think so. And here's what I think we're going to find out. Is we're going to find out some of these guys besides Moss that played with Brady. Brady kind of elevated them to where they're at. He always made sure they got the right people in the right spots. And you could not double down on a guy with Brady without risking that you're going to get it. You know, he's going to hit you somewhere else. So great player, but yeah, you've already mentioned some players that should be above him. And I don't know. I don't see it. I mean, good. I mean, I'll give you everything. Like you said, he's an incredibly gritty player. He's toughed out through injury. He's toughed out through all this stuff and he's been able to do it. But to just sit here and say he's a Hall of Famer, he's definitely not a first ballot Hall of Famer. And like I say, if you start factoring in this thing with rings, well, then everybody that played with Brady is going to be in the Hall of Fame because they all got a ton of rings.
That's right. True. Well, and now, so Dustin Smith, who knows very little about football, but he says that Welker was great, but not as good as Edelman. I just read you the stats, Smith. I mean, Wes Welker was the man. I mean, come on, you know, let's talk about this. I'm not sure where the difference is. Now, Grant, once again, in the playoffs, you know, maybe Edelman was a little bit better than Welker, you know, but, you know, and here's my thought. Hey, Lane, you bring up a good point. If everybody played with Tom Brady and got a ring, you know, should be in the Hall of Fame. Maybe that's something that the NFL ought to do because you don't see that kind of dominance very often. They ought to just put the whole damn thing in there. All the Patriots, you're all in. Bang, get your wing. You know, Brady gets his own statue. You get your wing.
Just be done with it.
Yeah. You just be done with it. And then
You get through it. You could, if you talk about greatness over an extended period of time, well, what about the Bills? Just because they lost in the Super Bowl every year, they dominated the AFC when they were in it.
Yes, so they did.
It's like, you know, should all those guys be in there as well? I mean,
Lynn Swann's a Hall of Famer, right? Right.
Lynn Swann is Hall of Fame.
So it's so
and that's a different era. Dustin Smith, that's a different era. Yeah.
It is though. It is interesting though. Like if you say like Lynn Swann, Jerry Rice, you know, pick another superstar, then like Julian Edelman. I don't know.
I mean, nothing against the guy. He's a good player, but there's no way he's. I can't see it, but mate, you never know what they're gonna do. First ballot, I can't see that. I could see it being down the road though. Because he was one hell of a player. I mean, he really was. Right. So
it was funny. Look, how does that happen? Like, they either get in or they don't, you know, like, oh, you know what? We're just joking. Just kidding. We got you last time. Go ahead and get in there. That's fine. You haven't done anything since then, but no one else deserves it this year. So we'll put you in because no one else is worthy.
That's right. Yeah. And Dylan Schroyer with a great comment here. He's going to burn down Dustin Smith's house if Aaron Rodgers ends up with the Pats. And once again, the Green Bay Packers, I don't know what the hell they're doing with Aaron Rodgers. He's hosting Jeopardy. Things are up in the air. But you know what? This is the way I look at it. If you are Green Bay and you're not going to be committed to this guy, then trade him. Get something out of it.
What are you doing? Right. Exactly.
Yeah, just get something out of it. If you don't want him around, fine. But think what you could get for an Aaron Rodgers who's still got several good years left. You get him some weapons around him, and Aaron Rodgers is frigging unstoppable, which the Packers just never could seem to do, but someone else could.
I just don't understand that. Like, what are they doing? Why? How do you?
I don't know.
Just you're just almost not spoiled. You know, you'd like to think these guys are obviously they're brilliant in what they do, and it's like, how do you not just load up on talent to throw at Rodgers and just go win as many Super Bowls as you can? You know,
look,
I just don't understand that.
The writing's on the wall when they drafted a first rounder as a backup.
last year.
You don't draft a first round quarterback
as
a backup unless you had some other thoughts about what's going on. And maybe they are playing the price game with him right now. They're driving it up. Everybody's going to start salivating because they want Rodgers and they'll offer the world right before the draft. So then they'll be able to build more around the Green Bay. I mean, this could be a move that they want to do and it'll make a bunch of Packer fans mad, but at the same time,
me happy.
Yeah. But and then wherever he goes, it's going to make that team happy. I mean, you know.
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, absolutely. And if I am, you know, like a New England, something like that. Now, New England's looking like they might move up in the draft or something like they always do, you know, maybe get them what they think is the future. But if I'm New England, I'm picking up the phone. You know, I'm calling the Packers like, let's talk. You know, you obviously don't want him in seat. I've seen Belichick do some amazing things when it comes to, you know, getting the players that he needs, stuff like that. So it just, I'm waiting on the team to do something. So, you know, we'll see. We'll see, but it is what it is. All right, topic number four. North Texas softball pitcher Hope Troutwain, perfect game, 21 Ks. Did you guys see the friggin' highlights of this?
I read the article, but that's just a bunch crazy.
It's just a bunch of strikes, all that is.
Just a bunch of friggin' strikes. Probably didn't take very long, you know.
I did read something about that game did not last that long.
I bet not. So about like Jimmy Finch, that all-star game against Albert Pujols, all those major league players, just wham, 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 good night. So
I was going to bring that up. You know, you give the distance and the speed that these ladies pitch, I don't know how any of them hit the ball.
No, I don't either. Well, that's why you see a lot of no-hitters. I mean, it's just damn near impossible. I think they'll move the damn mound back. I mean, give me a break. You know, it's but
either move it
this
forward
is the,
or back, one of the two. I don't know.
Yeah, right. Ooh, yeah. Yeah, good God. Move this forward. Apparently is the first time this has ever happened. There have been several 21 strikeout games, but they've given up hits. In fact, she herself has done this like at least another time, if not two more times, where she's had 21 strikeouts. But in one game, she gave up five hits and 21 Ks. Five hits, 21 Ks.
That's so weird. I can't compute that.
You know what that's called? Like this. Just close your eyes and swing and get lucky. You know, that's all
bunting.
To it.
I just bunt every time.
That was me in Little League.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. But, I close my eyes and swing all the time. So.
Hey, you know, Dustin Smith, let me tell you something. Dustin Smith, once again, I get on here and run his mouth. He says, compares to Sammy's Friday night full of strikeouts. Brother, I hit more home runs than you can ever imagine. Woo! But, yeah, there's no striking out with Sammy, baby. But, anyway, so incredible feat. Wow, what a talent. I'm surprised she's only at North Texas. Might be a transfer coming up down the road. Some team will pick her up. Sounds like she's pretty damn good. But Angela Baird Vincent says, sounds like Mary Warren in the Florida Girls Softball League. Thank God I was on her team. Ooh, Mary Warren, pitcher. How about that? Well, that good. What an athlete. Yeah, basketball. Yeah. You know, little softball, athlete.
I'll do another shout out. Another really good pitcher was from Flores days was Lacey Briscoe. She could smoke the ball. She threw hard.
She played
somewhere too, but I'm the brain. I mean, there's a lot in this, but it's not all coming to me right now.
Well, there's too much. Sometimes you got to, I mean, there's files you got to get past, all that. Yeah. I hate to say this, but Tara Saylor was a great pitcher. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Her sister Amy was a great pitcher. I mean, And once again, if you or I tried to go up there, we have no prayer. I mean, they're whipping that ball, and it's just – and the things they can do with it, it's just insane. Well, it's not fair.
Some can go scared. Up, right? Like, they can throw that rise ball, and it's
not a prayer. It's ridiculous.
Physics. Yeah.
Yeah, it's so, ridiculous. So it's not fair at all. All right, and our final topic today is getting close to the real Dulaney, the real show coming on tonight. But our final topic, Scottie Pippen's son, Scottie Pippen Jr., who played at Vandy – this past year is making himself eligible for the draft. I don't guess he has an agent, so he's just kind of testing the waters. He may go back to Vandy, but averaged 20.8 points per game and 4.8 assists. So hell of a player. Wonder where he got that from. But your thoughts, how old do you feel when you hear Scottie Pippen's son is going into the draft? So, do we feel old now, gentlemen, as if we didn't before?
Well, let me make it feel worse. I just had to Google real quick to see how old Scottie Pippen is. You guys want to take a guess?
God, he's got to be, what, 55?
57. I'm 44. I'm 44.
55.
Oh, that's right. 55 years old. Jeez. Wow. Sounds like his kid's a hell of a player. Don't know if he'll get drafted or not, but he's going to test the waters, see what happens. My hope for him that, unlike his dad, I hope he doesn't have to carry the team like his dad had to carry the Bulls because his dad had to do everything else while Michael shot the ball 40 times a game. So that's my hope for Scotty Pippen that gets on a team with some help. I'm just saying. But
it took several months to get it out, but you got it out of your system on the show, didn't you?
Yeah, I did. Yeah. So
I appreciate the fact you don't hold back, Sam. I mean, we're glad.
No, people
want our hot takes, right? So, they want to know exactly.
Scotty Pippen doesn't get enough credit. You guys know it. He doesn't get enough credit. He should get credit.
He's considered one of the top 100 players of all time. I think he
needs more credit. More than that.
I tell you what. And when I play against my son Michael in NBA 2K, Scotty's a badass on there. In fact, he beat me with the 90 whatever Bulls. I don't forget who I was, but Scotty Pippen was leading scorer 55 points. You know,
nice
10 boards. Nice. Yeah,
what a talent! What a talent!
I have one other thing, and I don't want to delay bringing on the real Dulaney, but there was one other sports story I wanted to bring up. Did you see the story about live PBA bowling? The ginger assassin hits a 7-10 split on 7-10
split, and the dude had a mullet that was just shining red fire.
All you got to type in is ginger assassin and bowling.
Ginger assassin. What a great friggin' nickname.
Ginger assassin.
And the 7-10 split, I mean, in a tournament, no less. What a shot. I mean, good God, what a shot. Yeah,
it was magical. Yeah, it really was.
Yeah, and Dustin Smith, how dare you? He just called me the Tony Koo coach of this show. That is ridiculous. Probably like the BJ Armstrong, you know, very short. But I do my damn job, and that's it. So, but anyway,
I'm going to go get Mrs. Dulaney, get fired up here.
It's about the time. Now, while Delaney's doing that, I want to mention around the old Flora area, the Queen of Hearts Lane Pie is going to be at the Elks. I guess it's every week now they're doing that, up to like $22,000. And what they're doing that for is they're raising money for basically all the athletic teams around that area. So, you know, get out there, support that. It's going to be at the Elks. It's going to be at, I hate to say this, but Venue 720 with Dustin Smith. I think he's going to do that from time to time. I don't know. But nevertheless, a really good cause. So, you know, if you want a chance to, you know, get you a Queen of Hearts, maybe get you a little bit of money, Lane Pie. I think Altamont just had theirs. Somebody finally won theirs and won $250,000. So not too bad. And I mean, Altamont, the money that they're doing with that, I think they put up like new lights and stuff like that. So, so this group, you know, Justin Cook and Amy Hurtis and people like that are doing a lot of good things. So get out there and support that every Saturday night. I think you can actually get the tickets. And the good thing is you don't have to be there in person. You can buy the tickets from Justin. He's got a Venmo and all that stuff. So check that out. And all that. So, and once again, before we start with the lovely Crystal Dulaney lounging upon her couch, we want to thank Bill Atwood again for sponsoring the show. So if you need insurance, make sure and contact him, North Wayne Insurance Agency. So now it is time for what everyone came to see, the artist that is Crystal Dulaney. I have one of your pieces, as it looks like I'm in outer space, but very cool looking. So Crystal, welcome to the show. Thank you for making the time. How are you doing this evening?
I'm doing great. Thank you.
Great. So first and foremost, incredible talent. Folks need to, now what is your webpage where people can go to and see all your creations and buy these creations that you make?
Yep. It's Dulaney Artworks, and it's Dulaney, and then artworks with the S.com.
Not very good. So, and in fact, Lane Pie may bring that up here in a moment, or whenever he fixes it, a little screen sharing, we'll figure it out. But just kind of go through some of the pieces that you have on there. Oh, there it goes. Look at this. Look at this technology that's going on right now, Chris. Do you see what's happened? Look at this. I mean, it's amazing. So,
I can't see anything.
Okay. Well, yeah, anyway, I promise you it's happening right now. But there's a shop button, and that's it, Lane Pie. So anyway, you can go on there, look around, incredible pieces that are on there. And you do this on a variety of things, which we're going to talk about how the hell you do this and come up with this. But it's very impressive. I don't know that I've ever seen artwork like this before, but it's cool as hell. So, have you always been artistic ever since you were a little kid, or is this something that you've gone along? She's being attacked by a feral cat. We're seeing this on live TV right now, folks. There's a wild cat in the house that is attacking her, but the interview goes on. So have you always been artistic ever since you were a little kid, or is this just something that you've worked on?
You know, I've always been artistic. When we moved into this house, we wanted new countertops, and they were really expensive, you know? Mm-hmm. And Brian actually came up with a video that showed someone doing resin countertops, and I thought that they were super cool. And I did them, dove right in, and we were really excited and impressed with the results. And I don't know, maybe 6 months or so after that, I started seeing in the art world people using resin for artwork. And it just got me super excited. And I kind of went from there with the kind of things I'm doing now. You know, I was self-employed as a photographer for a long time, which is an art form too, you know, and always loved artsy, craftsy kinds of things. But this is a little different, a little bigger scale. Mm-hmm. Very cool.
Yeah, I was gonna say I follow a lot of things on Twitter and so forth where they married the resin and the woodworking like you have off to the side there and some of your other pieces. I love that. I think they actually work very well together. They look very, it's just really a neat look to when they put that resin in there, and the resin can get a really nice gloss to it. So I always think it's really cool.
It's very cool. It's exciting. It's an exciting world.
All right. So how does one, where do you come up with these ideas? Because this is like, I mean, I look at these and I'm like, how the hell do you even begin to start to create something like this? So take us through the process of how you create these things.
Well, you know, I get inspiration from other artists. You know, I definitely see some cool artwork out there that might give me a bit of excitement. Okay. I know.
Yeah. Are those pumas? What do you got going on up there in Wisconsin? What is this? Good God. Chaos. Yeah.
They like someone's voice, I think. I don't know.
No, that's it. Yeah. What kind of cats are those, by the way? Sorry, I'm distracted, but what kind of cats are those?
No. But I'm usually inspired by, you know, when I see other pieces of art or even interior design, specific colors or color combinations get me going.
And me.
I really love, you know, crystals and stones. And a lot of what I do is that kind of geode art. Kind of imitating, you know, an agate that's been cut or broken open. You know, so a lot of times, sometimes it's the substrate, you know, like the size that I want to paint on. A lot of times it's a client coming to me with a specific need, and then I get almost everybody's allowed me to just take the colors that they want or the size that they want and go for it, you know, and just create something. So there's all different kinds of things that I pull from. But there usually is a color or a stone or something that excites me, gets me going on a piece.
Wow. Dustin Smith, who works in decorative concrete, by the way, I don't know if you've ever done that, but decorative concrete, he says, do you prefer the 100% solid clear coats?
Definitely. Yeah. I actually use a couple different kinds of resin. You know, there's some that are called like a casting resin that'll do something really thick. Sometimes something that'll set right away, you know, and I'm mixing in different pigments. You know, I get most of my pigments from a place in Australia. Actually, I don't know what's so special about Australia, but they got the pigment thing down there. But yes, to answer that question, it is definitely a solid, hard, fast product. I'll even use countertop epoxy sometimes in the work.
Mm. Now, question, whenever you create these, are you able to do it like for instance, if I wanted you to create something and I gave you a couple colors, can you give, or do you do anything like on the computer to kind of show like this is how it turns out and you're able to make it that way? Or do you just start to, because it's, I mean, obviously there's stones and liquids and things like that, but can you give people kind of a preview of the way it goes? Or basically you just create it and then you show the picture when it's done and say, you know, this is it. What do you think? Do you like it? How does that work?
Yeah. You know, actually most of my clients like to be surprised, which I think is really cool. It's like they appreciate the artistic direction and just want to have this, you know, surprise at the end. I think that is so cool. I don't know that I could be that trusting with.
I'm not a trusting person. No, I can't do it.
But I always offer, you know, a lot of times I'll photograph a piece of what I'm doing, you know, especially if it's turned out really cool. A lot of times I try to do a sketch beforehand to show them the direction I'm going in. This is a very fluid art form though. And a lot of times it's out of my hands, what's going to happen and occur. The longer I do it, the more control I have, but in the end it's the boss, you know, and my clients completely get that, you know, so a lot of times I'll go with a sketch and go from there. Every once in a while, I'm not feeling great about a piece, you know, like maybe it's not colors I would have used. And I'm not feeling comfortable. And so a lot of times I'll bring the client into the process at that point and say, this is what I've got so far. I would like to do this, and it may even be changing the direction. And almost always they're game for it. You know, they trust that if I'm not liking how it's going, they're probably not going to like the final result either. So it's a little bit of all of that.
Yeah, it's telling, babe, sometimes when you need that extra special oomph, we just make out a little bit, and then
that is awesome.
Yeah, we paint our bodies and roll around on the canvas.
Yeah, fantastic.
Oh, you just gave it all away though.
Ooh, no, keep going.
That's how the magic happens in both art and life.
Right. So. That's right. That's the creation. Yeah, indeed.
Yeah. So do you ever use, you know, our co-host as an inspiration in any of your pieces? Have you ever done that before?
Lane?
Something with a large head.
Yeah.
Large goddamn head.
That damn piece would weigh like 500 pounds. My right. God.
Oh my God.
Yeah, but no, with Sir Dulaney, has he ever been an inspiration for one of your pieces?
Gosh, I don't know that I'd say inspiration, but you know, he is an incredible encouragement. He's never ever said, I don't think that looks very good. He's always like, that's awesome. And it might be a piece that I'm looking at going, I don't like it. But now a lot of the wood stuff, he's involved in the creation of that too. Which is why we wanted to do the Dulaney artworks instead of like Crystal Dulaney artworks. At this point, you know, the wall art of course is all me, but a lot of the wood things, he's done planing and sanding and shaping.
Ooh.
You know, sometimes he's felt like my little bitch, I think he said.
Good.
That's good. Could be worse. There's worse things. Yeah.
It's one thing that we know that Dulaney always likes his wood. So that's right. So yeah.
Ooh, here's some of Delaney's wood.
Ooh.
Look how big that sucking.
That's a big piece of wood.
This one's not online right now, but it is available. But I mean, this is all him.
Wow.
And what kind of wood do you prefer? What kind of wood would you use?
Walnut, we love. This is oak though. I had a client actually give me a few really beautiful pieces of wood. And Brian being the wood expert that he is.
Especially in the morning.
Seriously, look how gorgeous, you know.
It is. Cool as hell. Yeah.
And he's a big part of that, you know. And we would love to like you were saying earlier, like the resin tables and things like that. That's definitely a direction that we want to go in and would love to do more of together. So that's a super exciting thing for our future.
Wow.
Problem is she's always has some other like commission project that just continues to, she's always juggling three or four of those at a time. So we don't always have time for stuff for our own house. You know, like there's a couple things we want to do for our house, but you know, mama's busy doing stuff.
A cobbler's kid has no shoes, Dulaney. That's just the way it goes. You know, I mean, that's just, yeah. You know, I mean, I've seen it too many times.
Figure out that balance somehow. I think, you know.
Right. Yeah,
that's right. Now, how long does like you know these pieces that we see online, in the big wall hangings? How long does that take to complete that project?
You know, I get asked that all the time. It's definitely time consuming. The thing that's difficult though is like I think a lot of artists, like if you think of somebody painting with acrylics and creating a landscape, you know, they're sitting in front of that canvas working on just that canvas and they can tell you how many hours. But in my case, I have to wait for each layer to set up, and there's layer upon layer upon layer. So you know, you've got the longest pot time, or in other words, how long I have until the resin starts to harden, you know. The longest resin that I have, it takes about an hour and a half, and whereas the shortest is like 10 minutes. So if I'm doing a layer with that 10 minute resin, that's all I have is that 10 minutes to get down what I want to get down. That's not a completed piece though, you know. I'll have to come back another time and do this layer and then do that layer. So I usually have several pieces going at once, four or five pieces going at once. So it's really tough to know how long one specific piece takes, you know, and some I get really lucky and I'm really happy maybe three layers in, and then some can take like 15 layers, you know.
Oh my God. Wow. Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, how much really do these heavy. Like, yeah, like these wall painting or these not wall paintings, but these walls that our friend Beth Frost Schnarr bought a piece from you. Thing looks huge. How heavy are these things? I mean, they look extremely heavy. So how, what's the average weight on those big wall hangings?
Yeah, you know, it's going to depend on if it's on canvas or wood, and I'm doing mm-hmm. mostly wood now. I'd say they're not as heavy as you'd think. Probably 30 pounds is about what you'd see a piece like that. Do you think, babe?
That's probably 20, about right. 30? Yeah, something Ooh. Like that.
Wow. Size of my head. That's my, the weight of my head.
So right.
Say he better have good anchors in that wall, because Lane, you know, that's why his neck's so good. Because if not, he's head yeah. bouncing off the desk.
Make sure you find a stud if you're going to hang these up. Don't yeah. just put them on a little drywall. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, yeah. you know, some drywall anchors would be fine, but you know, you're going to pay for a nice piece like that. Find a nice spot that can hang it absolutely. Safely.
Yep.
Mm. Interesting. Now, J.R. Lewis makes a great comment here. He says, after seeing Mrs. Dulaney, I feel even more sorry for her than I did before. She's very interesting, really scratches his head. He can't figure it out. None of us can, because you're a beautiful woman. You're very interesting, very artistic. And yet, so tell us, how did this happen? How did you two meet? Let's get into this here. So we've talked smart, but let's talk about the love. How did you two meet? How did he sweep you off your feet? Yeah, I mean, because there's a lot of love on this show. How did it happen? And how does he keep the fires burning? So let's talk about that.
Oh, man. Well, we actually met several years ago. We were photographers together, actually. Did you guys know about Brian being a really amazing photographer?
I've seen some pictures and I've heard of the tales. Yes, he's quite talented.
Honestly, yes. I just thought he took pictures of the people on the inside. I did not know he also did the pictures on the outside. So
doing both.
The inside and outside. Yeah. Yep, that's amazing. His gig. Absolutely. But we were both photographers in our own right. And when it came to weddings, neither one of us were thrilled about weddings.
Agreed.
But we were friends. And when we get hired for a wedding, we would bring the other one in, you know, to help shoot it. So we did some of those. And so that, you know, that's kind of how we went to the same church, actually, many years ago. And it wasn't until how long, babe? Eight years ago?
Yeah, 2014. Yeah, seven.
Yeah. Like we kind of went our separate ways. My marriage actually broke up, and I had moved to Appleton, you know, about 4 hours from here. 3 hours from here, and had been coming back and forth because the majority of my photography clients were here in La Crosse, and he just reached out to me one day, and mm-hmm. We had a conversation, and it was the day that I was moving back to La Crosse, which was kind of crazy.
Ooh, timing.
But no, I was dating a guy that I really liked, you know, and
and we all make decisions. Yeah.
But, some better than others.
Mm-hmm. And then I think like kind of what started it all was then he gotten divorced himself. I was doing a shoot at a park here, and there's a ballpark in the same area, and he was at the game with some friends, and we ended up like meeting, you know, we hadn't seen each other for probably a couple of years. We met and ended up out there talking, I think, like until the rest of the game, right, babe? Like you never even went back in.
Oh, sparks flew, emotions ran high. Tractor beam.
I've got this right now. Let's pitch this movie. I'm gonna call it long exposure. Pictures exposed. I mean, right now.
Yeah.
Someone get Hollywood on the line.
I mean, who are we gonna have play Dulaney? Because we'll have Crystal play herself, but who are we going to have play Dulaney?
Oh, I think he plays
Nicolas
himself.
Cage.
Yeah. Nicolas Cage.
Nicolas Cage. I like that.
For that NASCAR dude.
Oh, yeah. Kyle Busch, apparently.
Kyle Busch. Nice.
I don't know if he's an actor or not. But
Absolutely. You know. Yes. So now, were you aware of his athletic prowess from back in the day? Oh,
nope.
Track star, basketball star. He's pretty good. Pretty athletic.
I know.
So mm-hmm.
also,
he's mentioned it.
Also, I can cut a rug on the dance floor if I remember right.
Oh, really?
Right. Oh, yeah. Well, Yeah, at the reunion.
At the reunion, yeah. Oh, that's right. Yes, she was. That's right. You were at that. That's when I first met her. So
yeah, we just had started dating, actually.
And imagine,
just started dating, man.
Yes.
She met me on one of my best nights. I was.
Was that after the touchdown catch in the alumni game?
I think so.
Yeah. Oh, what a show that night was. Oh my God, so great, so great. So, Crystal, your thoughts on glamour shots? I mean, you're a photographer. What are your thoughts?
Oh, they're wonderful.
Mm-hmm. Memories for a lifetime, really. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I like them. I mean, you don't see those enough. Sears, I don't think, does them anymore. I don't know that Walmart does. So, I mean, there's that. Have you had, as just as a practice, have you had Dulaney do like a photo shoot for you, maybe where he's like a George Costanza, you know, where he's just in his boxers, something like that? Has that happened? Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. His sister, who's like, she's, I don't know if you'd call her shy. But you know Dulaney, right? His whole family's like this. You know Kyle.
Mm-hmm.
His sister's always like, oh God, oh God, Brian, you know, like, but it was her. She came up with this idea to have Brian, her husband, Chris, and Kyle do a calendar for Kyle's wife, Jen.
Fantastic. That's so great. Stuff.
There was like a gold Speedo involved.
We need these pictures. Right, I was gonna say, how do we get these pictures? That's what I want to know. So
that's a question. I'm not sure. We'll have to find
they exist. They're out there. They're somewhere.
Oh my God. It's so funny. Mm-hmm. It's great.
Now I do have a complaint with you, Crystal. I requested this a long time ago. I don't know if you have upset customers or not. I requested this. I never received it. I was wanting a picture of Dulaney and Dickie, in their leather jackets without shirts on black velvet. And I get to receive that. So are you still working on that? Because I would like that in, you know, with the rocks, if you can do it, you know, in the rocks and then the layers. I don't want to just paint it. I want it like, you know, like the outer space scene that I got, but I want it like that. Is that happening? How's that coming along?
It sounds like a nice commission piece.
Yeah, it does.
Yeah, I've been working at it hard, but I haven't gotten my deposit yet.
So. Oh, you know, that's in the mail. That is actually in the mail. So, you know, great question here from Dustin Smith. Who handles wood better, Kyle or Brian? A great question.
Ooh.
Crystal, your thoughts? Yeah, and Brian will get your thoughts too.
So like, she's thoughts. Like reluctantly. Oh, probably Brian. I guess probably.
I guess Brian. I don't know. Whatever.
Yeah. Reluctantly.
It's a good question, though. It's a good question. So Lane, what other questions do you have for the artiste? That is what I. You know, one question I got while Lane's thinking, because I can see the motors turning. Brian mentioned some commission pieces that you're doing. So do you? What are you doing work for? You know, companies. What is your, do you do a lot more work for people like that, or is it more just individuals that want them in their home? What is most of your work for?
No, it's all individuals. I think it's, you know, I certainly would entertain a commission like that for a company, but I tell you, I really love creating something for a person. I get really excited. You know, it's kind of a spiritual process for me. And once I've had a chance to talk to somebody and, find out the reason why they want the painting. You know, the majority of the people that have commissioned me have never commissioned an artist before. And it's a really cool, really, really cool process. I do want to mention too, I've had some frustration from people that don't know me, you know, maybe found me on Instagram or something. When you go to my site, I've been so busy, which is a good thing, but I don't have a lot of new pieces on the site. Nor do I do very good on keeping up with my social media. So I just like to tell people that if you go to the site, use it as somewhere to get an idea and then talk to me and we can, you know, get a commission.
Like, I like this piece, but could you do these colors type thing?
You got it. You got it. Because it's a little frustrating. All of my sold pieces are there. And so when you go on there, there's like maybe 5% are available to buy. Mm-hmm. You know, just because lately it's been mostly commissions. So there's a few pieces that I have ready and done that aren't up there just because I haven't had the photography done, but I haven't gotten it up. So that's I think important for your listeners to know that, you know, oh, and by the way, if someone sends me a message off of this show, I will give 10% off of any piece that's on there or a commission.
Oh, well,
they just have to message me.
And you know what? Show. You know what? The guys that are watching this show, if you go on this website, and the website again is what? Dulaney
Artworks.
Artworks.com. Go on there, check this out. Your wives, girlfriends, whatever, you're always like, I don't know what to get her, you know, Mother's Day is coming up, things like that. There, you go and check this out. There's no way she wouldn't love this. So if you know her favorite colors, you see a design on there that you think's pretty cool, guaranteed you knock it out of the park with something like this. Yeah. And if you message her, you get 10%. I'll just message the show. Boy, you talk about a win-win. That's fantastic. Yeah. That's very nice of you. Very nice. Yes, yeah,
very
indeed.
Nice.
Mm-hmm. Lane, what else you got for this fine woman before we can let her go?
I'm sure you do, you know, you have customers or you have commission work from all around, but this stuff can always be shipped, right? Like you can actually have it mailed and everything like that. So there's no issue with that. Awesome.
You know, it sure can. I don't like to do that. I sent a piece to Ohio once that got stuck, like went into UPS limbo.
Oh.
And thankfully it made it to her, but it was cracked when it got there. Oh. I learned a lot though in that situation. As far as like the packaging and I think anything that is shipping away is like that is going to be put into a wooden crate from now on, you know, and not just, I mean, I thought I packed the hell out of it, but it's going to go in a wooden crate.
Yeah.
But I will tell you, if I can drive there, I will, you know, that's what I've done with our past few commissions, even if it means, well, shipping something like that is expensive.
Yeah.
And so, it's usually less expensive to pay me my gas to deliver it. And then I know I get to meet the buyer in person, you know, give tips even on how to hang it. Mm-hmm. It sounds maybe ridiculous that I would drive halfway across the country, but I would feel better to do that. Not that I have to do that, but that kind of broke my heart a little when that happened.
Oh, absolutely.
You know?
Yeah.
Something I like now. Those runs are fun, you know. We drive.
Great question here from Devin Daniels, who I do believe is opening up a sweet ass coffee shop in Flora. He says, lame question. It's not a lame question. There's no such things. Is an open and closed sign able to be made? So it's going to be a cool little coffee shop type thing. Open, closed sign. Is that something that's possible?
Oh, yeah. Anything's possible.
Oh, don't you love it? I mean, you talk about an artist, she can make it happen.
Hey, you know what, boys? I like these trips to deliver pieces of art because you know what you can do on the way there?
Bourbon shop.
Bourbon
That's
shop.
Right, sir.
Bourbon.
That's right. That's right.
Well, see.
In fact, you got a bourbon to pick up the lady anyway, so you need to get
I know.
That's a win-win.
I was just trying to think of a way to, like, maybe I could commission a piece, and then I would just come up, instead of her having to drive, I'd come up and I'd just drink some of Delaney's bourbon.
You're welcome to.
Man, go up to God's
win-win.
Yeah.
Just schedule them at 2 weeks of spring and summer that they have. Don't go any other time because you'll fall down driveways. So, now, let's talk about this. How concerned are you for your husband's health and safety? Are you thinking about moving at any point in time? Or do you have a nice insurance policy on him? What's going on there? Your thoughts?
Yes, nice insurance policy.
Good.
Yes. I'm telling you, he hired kids this year to clear the driveway, which Smart. Is nice.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But I'm telling you, there's so much fun to be had. I mean, we have a huge window that overlooks the driveway and the cameras.
Oh God, they never
and
get
he
all
bounces,
those videos.
So.
Yeah, so great, so great.
Maybe next year, babe.
And I'll ask two final questions here, and then let you get back to your evening. And once again, thanks for making the time. One, have you ever created a piece that, whenever you got done, you just basically hated it and just smashed it and started over? You ever done that?
No, I've never smashed anything, but I've definitely not been happy. Mm-hmm. Gosh, who is it? There's some famous guy that said, never quit until you're proud. And I really, really believe that. The amazing thing about resin is that, you can cover it in black resin, white resin, and start all over, you know? So it's kind of sad. You maybe lost 100% of your profit because you weren't happy with it, but it you just, you know, the substrate's still good. You just cover it up, start all over again.
I'll be damned. Yeah. And can you, you know, just, I don't know how long, I'm sure this could be quite the thing, but just start to finish, take us through the process of making one of these pieces. How do you do it?
Sure. Well, in most cases, I need to seal the wood, you know, so I feel like I have to watch myself with you guys.
I don't know what you mean. No. I mean, is that with latex, or is that with
stop being immature, babe?
Yeah, lambskin, or
oh my god,
I don't know.
Like,
we're professionals.
Yeah, come on, it's a question. I don't know. Yeah.
Jesus.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But so, I typically will seal with like spray paint, so that I, you know, that's kind of like layer number one. Problem is that wood is porous. Well, even canvas is porous, and you'll get bubbles that come through the resin if it's not sealed. So you seal it, and then you just start laying down, depending on what it is that you're going for, you know. Many times if it's a commissioned work and I've given them a sketch, I'll actually, I do the sketch to scale, not to scale, you know, like a, gosh, what's the word I'm looking for? Where, like if it's square, if it's gonna be a square painting, I'll draw my sketch on a square. And then literally section it out and draw it onto the substrate. that's about as close as I come. From there, it starts covering up my lines and it goes wherever it wants. But so possibly drawing it down. A lot of times I'll lay the crystals and stones out, you know, get a base color down and then just keep adding from there, you know. Sometimes I'm just doing a layer of sand, or I'm doing and not covering the whole thing, but stripes, you know, layers of sand, layers of glass. I use a lot of ground glass, you know, and it just keep building it and building it until it gets to the point that I love. I mean, it is the coolest. There's times when I'll tell Brian, I'm not liking how this is going, you know, but then the next
not time the I marriage, the it, art I'm piece. Like,
well, I mean, there's times where that gets brought up too. Oh, I'm sorry. Sure. Yeah. Yeah. Understandable.
Sorry.
But yeah.
Carry on,
yeah.
Babe. Sorry.
And it's fun. If you can use a torch, you know, that's something I have to get the bubbles out of the resin. So you use fire and a heat gun and a lot of manipulation. That's fun. Mm-hmm. It's good stuff.
Cool. Wow.
I don't know. Did you guys show, there was a video that,
no, we will share that. Actually, we're going to share that on the page probably,
okay,
to where people can see that, because that looks, I mean, it's cool as hell just to watch that happen. So very cool, very neat. So once again, folks, DulaneyArtworks.com. Okay.
Yep.
Go and check that out. Once again, the pieces on there are already sold, but it gives you an idea, you know, of what's, you know, just some ideas basically. And then if you have certain colors, the wife, the girlfriend, whatever, maybe you enter it yourself, do that. Once again, if you find something that you like and contact Crystal, mention the show, you get 10% off on that. And what do you think is the turnaround on such a, granted it varies by size, I'm sure, but what would you say the turnaround would be if they contact you this week or something like that? What would be the turnaround?
It's going to really depend on how many commissions are ahead of you, you mm-hmm. know, mm-hmm. Usually about a month is pretty average. Mm-hmm. But if I've got a lot of work ahead, then it, you know, obviously everybody goes in order. So mm-hmm. but I
can't rush greatness.
That's true. I was going to say, yeah. And, give the order also, and you know, shut up and wait. That's what I tell them on the phone. You shut your mouth. Don't ask again. I'll call you. Right. I mean, is that your customer service? I recommend it. Yeah.
That's so, I just give them to Dwayne.
Yeah, that's right.
But seriously, I mean, if it's for somebody's birthday or something like that, I think it would be really cool to just say, hey, I found this artist, I'm going to buy you a painting, and then let them let the person that's getting the mm-hmm. art call me. I think art's really personal, you know, and mm-hmm. One person may really love a style and the next person doesn't. And that would be really heartbreaking if somebody spent a lot of money on a painting and then gave it to their wife and their wife hated it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right. Yeah. Now, yeah. Dylan Schroyer with a great question. And thank you, Dylan, for this. Coolest episode yet, which is great to hear because this is some cool ass shit. An arrowhead shaped piece would be so damn cool. Can the Delaney's make that? I got a pretty good feeling that you could. So arrowhead piece with, you know, things like that. I'm sure that's possible, right?
Of course. Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. I can't quite picture what
you know, Native American arrowheads that you see. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
So, yep.
For sure. I mean, anything's possible. For sure.
See, once again, Dylan. So there you go. Anything's possible. Kevin Garnett.
Miss Positivity.
That's right. Yep. So contact her and get her going and go from that way. So fantastic. Lane Pye, any other questions for our artist tonight?
No, thank you very much for coming on the show. It's really interesting. Like I said, the work is amazing, and folks, I would highly suggest, I mean, getting something like this because it's really unique. And just like any piece of art, that it's usually a legacy piece. With that resin, I mean, as long as you take care of it, it should last forever, and that's something you can hand down to kids and so forth. And like I said, the overall look, yeah, I think is timeless. I think it's a very classy look for the stuff. It's very unique and it's very classy. So, yeah,
absolutely.
You know, I'll answer that real quick. Mm-hmm. I can put ashes in it. I have done that, and that's extremely special.
Oh wow! I didn't think about that.
When you said a legacy piece, you know, that made me think of that.
Hell yeah. Instead of a damn urn that just sits there, right, it's in a beautiful, yeah, that's cool shit. Well, I didn't think about that. Mm-hmm. Oh, wow. So many things you can do, you know, when you're dealing with a creative person. Yeah, I wouldn't know where to start. But yes, so once again, folks, Mother's Day, it's always, you know, oh, send your flowers or a birthday flower. Guys, quit being lame. You know, do something new and interesting, exciting, or whatever. Guaranteed you get this, something like that. Oh, man.
You're making out that night, aren't you?
Yeah,
you're making
out that night. The action happens that night. That's why he smiles all the time. You see what I'm saying? You got to get that art going on. So, yes, contact her. She'll help you out 10% off if you mention the show, which is awesome. Thank you for doing that. But no better Mother's Day present than something like that. So that's extremely cool. So once again, Crystal, thank you again for making the time. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Back anytime. And we will, I don't know, Delaney, you can stick around. You know, we're just going to wrap up if you want. You know, if you got some thoughts or, you know, sports takes, you want to do something like
this
that.
This will be good.
Yeah, absolutely. But anyway, Lane Pie, as we finish up the show tonight, any positivity you'd like to share tonight? I know it's been a rough week, but any positivity?
It's been a rough week, but you know, mm-hmm, there's always a light at the end of the tunnel, and realize just when things get frustrating at work or home or whatever, that, you know, when you got a good base, and just like myself and Delaney both have, when you have a good woman to come home to, it makes things a lot better. So cherish those things, cherish the significant others in your life and your family and your kids and everything. And, mm-hmm, you know, it always is that ray of light. And then guess what? Everything tends to get better. I mean, you know, just you got to go through those down times to enjoy the up times. So just keep that in mind, as we've all, honestly, through this last year and change, we've been going through a lot of this. And so just remember, you know, positivity's things will get better. And you know, just keep your head up, and we all learn from this, and it'll make, once this current COVID stuff has passed us, we will appreciate so many more things. So
Indeed. Yes. Delaney, fresh crack of the night. What do you got going on? Fresh may not crack. Be fresh, but what do you got?
Well, it's pretty fresh from a couple of days ago. So Crystal and I went up to Marshfield, Wisconsin over the weekend to visit her aunt in the hospital. And I stumbled upon, you know, just happened to find a liquor store or 7 or 8 to check out. And I found one that has, I've been looking for this. There's a distillery called Starlight Distillery. They're a little bit young, but they have a lot of good stuff that people are really happy with. So I finally found a bottle. It's a double oak. So it's a 4.5 year double oak. It's 106 proof. It's, if you've had the Woodford double oak, it's not a lot different than that, or the Old Forester 1910 has got that extra char. It's just, you know, extra sweet and smoky, and then oaky. It's just really good. In fact, I end up getting another couple bottles of it, because it's a store pick as well. So, you know, that's my mm-hmm. bag.
Oh, very nice. Good stuff. Very cool. Yeah, indeed. And Crystal, do you enjoy a fine bourbon, or what's your choice? Oh, you do?
Well, I do. Oh. I actually liked it before he did.
Oh, did you turn him on to bourbon?
She did. Absolutely.
Oh, wow. Interesting. How about that? And one final question from Dylan Schroyer. That's not a normal cat. What breed is that? Half hyena, half cat. I don't think it's hyena, but what are those cats? Explain.
They're called Oriental short hair.
They're like a jungle cat.
So people know Siamese. They're Siamese bred. It's explained better than I am, obviously, hon.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. Siamese breeders, so they're 100% a Siamese cat, except for their coat. Siamese breeders, I think like in the 70s, decided to introduce the American short hair colors into the Siamese cat. So you get all these really cool, you know, I mean, everyone's seen a tabby cat, right? I mean, it's basically what she is. But she's got the Siamese long body and the big ears and the long face, you know, so it ends up with a really exotic looking animal. They're phenomenal mm-hmm. pets.
very sleek. The way they move looks like they're always hunting. Yeah, something like that. Yeah. So
smart
very cool.
too. They all play fetch like a dog too.
Yeah. I got really one that
fun.
Does
fun.
That. Yeah,
they're mm-hmm. fun.
Yeah. Very cool. Yeah. All right. And I will leave you guys with this. I found us a dumbass criminal of the week. Haven't done this in a while, but I found one. Just thought we might need to do this. So one word sums up today's dumbass wrong. A 59-year-old guy named Kevin is a home inspector in Michigan. While inspecting a house a few weeks ago, so close to you guys, not bad, while inspecting a house a few weeks ago, the homeowner happened to look at her nanny cam and saw something horrifying. Kevin was getting it on with a stuffed Elmo doll. And when he finished, he put the doll back where he found it. He was charged with several crimes. The judge banned him from being alone inside any homes in the future. Please never tickle Elmo like that. Just don't.
My.
So a tickle me Elmo doll got tickled, but in the wrong way, Lane. Top Lane in Florida, Illinois, you get that call. How do you handle it? What do you do?
Yeah, really? That's a good question.
I mean, the hard part is to decipher the willingness of the other participant, right? So
that's going to be difficult. But what if they can't speak and there's stuff
variety? You got a lot of things you're going to have to kind of address on that one. But, I think for the most part, the homeowner probably did not want that happening in their home, regardless of willing parties or not. So,
yeah. Wow. Boy, I mean, you got to be
It makes you wonder if it was the Elmo that talked, though. Like if it was that could talk.
I assume it would have been.
Yeah.
No means no. No. Something like that, this guy's a complete freak. So anyway, that's your dumbass girl of the week. I hate to think going to prison for, what are you in here for? Well, I molested a tickle me Elmo. So that would be hard time. Yeah. Hard time. So anyway, once again, I want to thank our guests, Crystal Dulaney, for coming on. Make sure and go to that website. Again, DelaneyArtworks.com. Get your orders to her. Mention the show. You get 10% off. She is incredible. Incredible talent. Guaranteed a piece that will last a lifetime in your house that will be talked about. And guaranteed you'll never see anything like it. It's incredible. So go on, check that website out. Get your ideas. And all you got to do is get her the colors and things like that. If you've got a different idea, let her know that too. Just like Dylan said, with an arrowhead piece, that's maybe something she's never done before, but I bet your ass it's going to turn out great if she ends up doing it. So cool as hell. And once again, thank you for Delaney for making the time. Lane Pie, making the time again, even after a rough week, does the techie stuff and contributes. So thanks to everybody again for watching. And thanks again for Bill Atwood for being our sponsor. Check him out. And we should have some news coming up here in the next probably couple days of something that's coming up pretty soon. Just don't want to say it yet until it's finalized, but something cool that we're going to be doing in the city of Florida, hopefully, to raise money for a good cause. And once again, check out the Queen of Hearts this weekend. Go up the Elks, get your ticket. If you can't make that, check out Justin Cook on Facebook and send him a message. He'll get you his Venmo and you go from there. Once again, for a good cause, it helps the kids of Florida. So other than that, Lane Pie, I think that's about it. So thanks again for watching, everybody. We'll see you next week. And Lane Pie, send us home, Big Daddy.